Hi, my name is Denis Slonev. I'm working for Virtuoso and I'm head of the core team in this company. We are working with QEMO for last 3 years and we're trying to do our best to improve the community project. So what is this presentation is all about? We are trying to improve the performance of the snapshots which are implemented in QEMO. This presentation will talk about some methods we have implemented and the performance results of this implementation. Also, I would talk something about how we see a future architecture of this feature. I think that current implementation is not good enough and we should improve it. We should definitely improve it. So, let's start from internal snapshots. The motivation of touching this feature was quite fantastic. In this sprint, our angry customer comes to us and say that he has a downtime during the snapshot operation for 300 seconds, which was not good for him. We have said to that customer that snapshot is synchronous, so this is working as it's working. We could not improve it right now without a big rework. But he said that he has a storage capacity, he has storage performance of 150 megabytes in a second, while the snapshot write speed was only 27 megabytes in a second. And this is a problem. So we have to start digging. We get the QEMO and see how the snapshot is implemented. The snapshot code stops virtual machine CPU, commit all pending IO operations, save CPU and device state. It's not big, it's several megabytes. After that, it saves all the RAM. And this takes most of the time. Once the RAM is saved, QEMO code makes disk snapshot and start virtual machine CPU. This is rough sequence, which could be further digged in, but this gives presentation of how this process is going on. We see that virtual machine CPU is stopped once the whole memory is saved to the disk. And that is why we have such big downtime. But how this memory is saved to the disk? Should start tracing the QEMO. And we see something like the following operations. We get sequential writes with not so bad buffer size. This buffer size is about 100 kilobytes, and this is written sequentially. So far, so good. But why this is so slow? QEMO is lying us with this trace? No, it's not lying. Let us see how this process is looking from the point of Linux kernel. From the point of Linux kernel, the situation is quite different. We see that we get read request, which is executed to the disk and is completed. This read request is small. It's 512 bytes. And we have next read request of the same size at the end of the data to be written. And only once both requests are completed, we get write request started. And this pattern of IO is performed all over the snapshot creation operations. This is not acceptable, and this is, should be fixed. Why this happens? This happens as they are using non-cached IO in QEMO. Why we are using non-cached IO in QEMO? Because this is faster. The problem in non-cached IO is that all requests are to be aligned by 512 bytes. They have to read the beginning of the request, end of the request, and only after that the IO is to be executed, actual IO. So, is non-cached IO is a problem? Not at all. Non-cached I/O works better for a lot of cases. In order to work with coroutines, cached I/O is to be executed in separate threads. So each I/O request is delegated to the worker thread where it is executed. For fast disks like NVMe disks with 1 million IOPS supported, this produce a lot of overhead. This also produce a lot of threads to perform execution. And also this requires a lot of memory in the host operating system. We have to have a lot of spare memory to get those I/O data buffered. Also, any cached I/O operations could result in unpredictable delay if we face throttling. So we prefer to stick with non-cached I/O operation and fix what we have to fix. What is also happening during snapshot creation? If we are using standard QCOW2 image format, the snapshot data is saved each time into new clusters. Each data saved to the disk is saved to a new QCOW2 cluster, and this introduces additional problems. If the I/O is not allowed to the cluster boundary, cluster allocation process calls for locate for each cluster area not covered by the data. Thus, we would have two metadata updates for each cluster operation. And this works not really good. We should align our data to cluster. This is not very complex. We have sequential stream, which is written by the migration code. We could split it for better pieces. And also what we have to change, we have to change the synchronicity of those operation. We should start the write and allow migration code to do its work while the data is written to the disk. This is also improves performance a lot. So with this in mind, we have to find a place where this code could be implemented. The migration code works originally with sockets through I/O channel object. This I/O channel is supported on QEMU file, and migration people do not want to have block dances inside the migration code. This is a bad from the encapsulation point of view. This code is to be placed somehow at block level. Thus, we should put our dances into block driver core without additional implementation in specific block drivers. Fortunately, there are no block drivers except QCOW2, which are widely used. Thus, we get our results. Original snapshot writing time for NVMe and HDD drives for non-cached file descriptors are improved 4x. This is quite a big win. We get avoided 2 additional I/O requests for reading due to aligning our data, and we have avoiding metadata updates. Thus, cached operations also benefit from this. This should be quite good. Those patches are sent already to mailing list and have been discussed by us, unfortunately not by QEMU maintainers. So we should do the same for snapshot reversion. Snapshot reversion is quite a bit different. If we would do the same and start request reading in the same queue, we would get bad results, unfortunately. I have tried that, and this was proven as non-working. We have to do a little bit different thing. We have to read the data in the same cluster aligned way, but without a queue. This queue can be reordered in coroutine engine of the QEMU block layer, and in this case, rotational disks works really bad. It should also be noted that rotational disks produces extremely good result in the current code. This result is unexpectedly good for me. They are reading by small chunks of the data around the page. And you would see later that rotational disks are performing 3 times faster in this case than in the ME drive. This is quite strange. So, what has been implemented here? We get megabyte requests for read, and this request is executed only one at a time. Its request is rearmed once the previous request is completed, or once we have a spare space in the limited buffer for the data kept in block driver. That's what we are trying to get. Okay, here are results. HDD results are basically quite similar. They are better by small margin. But for the NVMe, results are 10 times better. It's a little bit exceptional for me. Original performance of NVMe drive, as one can see with this number, is 3 times worse than original results of hard disk. This data has been obtained by reverting the snapshots of 4 gigabytes VM with HDD and NVMe over QEMU 5.1. Okay. What we have learned from the presentation above? We have learned that the good queue for write is mandatory. Cluster aligned I/O is mandatory for optimal block layer performance for any user of the QEMU block layer, for example, migration. Rotational disks have very good read ahead. And we can not have read ahead in at least some NVMe drives. In this case, non-aligned I/O and I/O with small chunks works really bad, as the latency of I/O operation influences a lot to the whole length of the operations. But all these things are really, really small tricks, which improves the operation in numbers, but the downtime will still be bad. We have, as you remember, 300 seconds downtime. With this fix implemented, we will have 75 seconds downtime for snapshot creation. This is much better, but this is not good enough. We should invent something better. Okay, we do have something better in mind. We have a background snapshot patch set, which is circulating in QEMU mailing list. What is all about? We are stopping virtual machine CPU, the same commit all pending I/O, save CPU and device state, and here the tricks come. They do not save the memory during downtime operation. They protect the memory for write. Make disk snapshot and start CPU again. So with this protection, we get a notification that the memory is about to be modified, and thus we could get those memory and save into the snapshot while the background thread is getting all other pages which are not touched by the guest. So with this approach, we would get very small downtime in comparison of what we have previously. And more importantly, we will have this downtime independent upon the RAM size of a virtual machine. Okay, this would be a miracle. Yes, yes, this would be a miracle. This is definitely could be implemented right now. The notification engine with user fault FD is already committed into the Linux kernel 5.7. And fortunately, the QEMU code, which is used for such a migration, was used as a unit test for those code. Thus, the feature is really working. We need to just get this code finally tuned and be ready to merge into the mainstream QEMU. So far, so good? Not really. There are several architectural problems. It is not possible to use original internal snapshot architecture. Right now, snapshots is used to the previous disk state inside QCO2 image of the virtual disk. Okay, not okay. It is not possible to have two active snapshots written at once in the current architecture. We should be able to serve guest requests to write disk data into the new state, and we should be able to serve memory updates coming from the user fault FD thread. Not possible. Thus, we have to save the data somewhere outside. Right now, the test patch set save migration stream to the outside file path to QEMU as a file descriptor. But this is not a final problem. We could do this, but in a brilliant fascinating future, we should be able to do something similar for snapshot revert operation. We should be able to do something like that. We should load CPU and devices state from the migration stream. Okay, that's good. We should start VM and load the memory once the guest access it. If the page is not in memory, page fault happens, and we should be able to find a page fault in a migration stream. Also, we should have a thread which is loading those memory pages in the background from migration stream. And here the trouble come. Migration stream is sequential. It do not have an index. So they are not able to find arbitrary memory page inside this file. So we should write this index to the stream? Not at all. The problem is that the amount of memory pages is quite big, especially if virtual machine is as big as 1 terabyte of memory. This index is a problem. The granularity of the data with one page requires a lot of memory to keep the index in memory. We should invent something better. Okay, creation of new format. Creation of new format is not simple and is not easy. We have spent in our past 1 year and a half to get some modification into QCO2 image format. So we should use something existing. What we should use? We should use QCO2 image, but use it differently. We should get the migration stream parsed. And CPU and device state can be saved as it saved originally. But the memory should be saved as a data into this QCO2 image, not to the migration stream as it has saved, but as a data. In this case, we would have all the features we can get from QCO2 image. We can get memory compression if we have written this data with whole clusters. We can have sparse as some memory is not present and so on. And also we have a very good index, which is working quite fast. That is what we are trying to implement now and we are working actively on. Okay, thank you very much for your attention and your question and suggestions are welcome. Thank you.